Consenting to be recorded. Dr. Prashant Singh Chauhan. My name is Dr. Prashant Singh Chauhan. I am Senior Product Manager for the Protein Sciences and Biopharma Division, wherein we represent biobanking solutions. So today we have with us Dr. Stephen Saversky from Eskion, who studied his chemistry at University of Leipzig. After his PhD at Frankfurt Institute of Cell Therapy and Immunology, he joined Eskion. At Eskion, he is working within the biobank division and consults new customers to design and establish their biobank repository. So today's session is going to focus mostly on what is biobank, what are the best practices for biobanking of your samples as per the duration. What are the challenges, what everybody globally was facing, and what is the solution which Eskion offers. So with this, I welcome you all, and I thank you all for joining us today for this session. I hand it over to Dr. Stephen for his remarks now. Dr. Stephen, up to you.
Dr. Prashant, thank you much for the introduction, and welcome to everybody here. Yeah, as Prashant already informed you, my name is Stefan, I'm a chemist, and I'm working for the company Eskion, and today I would like to take you on a small journey on the biobanking topic. Well, what does it mean? You know, of course, if you would say biobanking, yeah, it's a broad field, right? Biobanking, what does it mean? It could be a simple store, it could be a huge facility, whatever it means. But before we are diving into this topic more, let me give you a short overview on who Eskion is. The company Eskion is a German company. It's allocated half the distance between Berlin and Munich. So we are located in Gera. We have our own facility here. It's really allocated in the Green Woods, what you're seeing here on this picture. And here are working around 85 employees. Why I'm telling you this? Well, when this company was founded in 2005, we first started with something completely different. We have not started with biobanking at the beginning. This was an idea which came up by our CEO, Lutz Stones. And he said in 2009, hey, it would be good if we develop something for high quality samples. Well, at this time point, it was really interesting because, you know, we are a more technical driven company or engineer driven company. And we ask ourselves, what does it mean to have a biobank? Well, first of all, we thought, okay, we have somehow biological sample. This biological sample we would like to archive. So you could imagine we are just putting it into a biobank. However, this looks like. Biobank then will be open again after, let's say, a couple of months or years, and we are taking out the sample. Okay, this was clear so far. Then we also reached out to researchers. Well, what is your opinion about the biobank? They told us, well, if you take the sample in and you take the sample out, both dates should be, of course, equal. Okay, it was also understandable for us. Then we asked the researchers, hey, if you are thinking about equal states, what is the impact factor or the main impact factors to get this high quality samples, to archive the sample quality? Well, we analyzed it together with researchers again. We also asked ourselves, what does it mean, the biobanking? First of all, if you're thinking about biobanking, the first topic which is coming to your mind is it's storage. It's storage about samples. Well, for sure, this is one part of the biobanking, but we believe, from our opinion, the biobanking process, so the entire process, starts much earlier. So we believe the sample processing is the first step in front of the biobanking process. So that means at the moment that the sample processing here is done perfectly. Everything is under control. We have several SOPs and kits for it. Everything is cool, perfect. But then afterwards, the first step, the first critical step should be how to transfer the samples from the warm to frozen state. So how can I cool down my samples? First of all, that I know what is going on within the samples. So I would like to be able to measure the sample temperature, because otherwise it would be hard to evaluate if, for example, the freezing curve within the samples was perfectly matching to my threaded curve. Well, and also I would like to be able to compare freezing batches. So that means I would like to be able to compare my freezing batch of today with my freezing batch of tomorrow. Okay, pretty cool so far. Then we came to the point, well, if I have now frozen down my sample, what is the next critical step? Well, I would like to avoid that the sample is getting warm again. Yeah. So you can here make a comparison if you want with ice cream. If you go to the supermarket, you are buying ice cream and you hurry up and take care that this ice cream is not melting. And this is more or less the same with biological samples. So we were reaching out again to some researchers who has done some studies, for example, with PBMCs. They tried three different setups. The first one was to say, okay, we have one constantly cooled aliquot. This is, let's say, the ideal case. The second one is an aliquot which is going up to, let's say, warmer temperatures. So we are talking about temperatures of minus 100 degrees. And the third aliquot was warmed up to minus 60 degrees. And what was surprising about this is the constantly cooled one and the minus 100 sample have been on equal stage. Perfect. For the minus 60, lower viability and also lower potency for differentiation have been seen. Pretty cool. So it means what we have to do after the controlled rate freezing step, we have to handle our samples as cold as possible. Okay, we understood this. We developed something perfect. Well, when we then came to the point, okay, now we are thinking about long-term storage. So we are talking about maybe years, decades, or even much longer. So for 100, 200 years. Well, there we brought on board some physics. So that means we talked to the physics, hey, what are the key driver behind the process to archive sample quality for long-term storage? And they informed us there is something like critical temperatures, depending of course on the media which we are using. But the common sense at the moment is the sample should be stored below minus 130 degrees. Otherwise, we are losing sample quality. Okay, we said no problem. Then, you know, we are technical guys, we're saying, okay, then we would like to add something like a buffer zone on top. So that means we said the sample storage should not be at minus 130. It should be at minus 150, that we have at least 20 Kelvin left as a buffer zone. Okay, next point was, we have to think about biobanking process in general. You know, biobankings are like organisms. They are not fixed. They are not, you install once it, and then it always keeps on this level. No, they are like organism evolving over time. So that means you also have to think about a way how we can automate the entire process. So automate the entire process means we have to automate, or we must be able to be automate, the controlled rate freezing process, the sample transfer, and also the sample storage. Done, perfect. We said, this is one of the bullet points, we will take care of this. And then we also talked to the researchers again, who said, well, it's cool if you can do everything like the controlled rate freezing, sample transfer, and sample storage, if you can do this by good equipment. But if you're not recording what is going on here, then the total value of the sample is gone. Okay, so that means the last bullet point for us has been, there must be a qualified documentation behind, which is then recording and reporting automatically all parameters for each sample, and this for the entire life cycle. Okay, well, this was pretty interesting. Well, now maybe please take a look to your screen. We have a short survey here because you have seen that we have introduced a little bit the major pitfalls here. Now it would be interesting to listen to you what the critical steps for you would be during your sample management. So please just fill it in and then reply to it. Now, as I have told you already, we have multiple critical steps within the biobanking, starting from controlled rate freezing, going on with sample transfer, sample storage, then we need qualified documentation behind, and also possibility to add or install from the beginning some kind of automation, however it looks like. The main reason for this is really that the buyer wirings are not that fixed as it might sound from the beginning. So let me just show you this short video here. It gives you a small exemplary journey through time for a typical biobank. A typical biobank normally starts quite small. So let's say it's phase one. Within this phase, we are saying, okay, we need something like controlled wet freezing, and we need an automated store somehow because we know we would like to get best traceability. Okay, then we can start with the first room somewhere. We install the first equipment. But then over time, the management board or the dean said, hey, you're doing a great job. So we have to extend it. So you would like to handle more samples and we have to increase the throughput. No problem. Then we are just going to the vendor of choice saying, okay, now we're installing more equipment. So that means now we have higher storage capacity. You know, as it is, if you are successful, you can become also a victim of success. And then it could be that maybe your external partners or the entire hospital would like to store the samples. So then we need at least the possibility to be able to extend the facility, so the biobank, even later in field with additional modules. So then we maybe have then started with let's say 10,000 samples capacity. And now we have ended up with a capacity of 1 million samples. Pretty cool, I would say. And this, you know, keeps us flexible. And considering all of this, Ascan has decided to offer also something within the biobank field. And herein, we decided to get something modular. Modular hereby means we have equipment focusing on the entire typical workflow within the biobank. So that means including controlled freezing, going on with sample transfer, continues with sample storage, and then is finalized with documentation. So that means every operator of a biobank can select the equipment of choice. And you can extend this if you want with something like automation features. So that means you can start maybe quite small and then later on you can get automation on board if you would like to get it. Okay, well, it's interesting if somebody speaks about general topics, speaks about how it can maybe looks like. Now it's time to take a deeper look on what Ascan is really offering. What you see here, these are the six major topics which is Ascan offering with regards of biobanking. So this is ranging exactly and matching also perfectly with a typical workflow of a biobank, starting with controlled wet freezing, going on with sample storage, continues with documentation and implementation, and then also like something on top, there's a possibility to get smaller equipment, so small tools, for example, for sample identification, which can be used at room temperature down to minus 150, accessories, and then also the consulting part. Now, take a look what it really means. The controlled wet freezing devices are named workbench and automated workbench. They are really for controlled wet freezing. Within the devices, it's possible to run multiple batches in parallel. So that means you can have, let's say, the first freezing process started for the cells. The second one is might running for tissues, and something like the third one is maybe for something like a mixed setup. The cool thing about the devices so far is not only for controlled wet freezing, you also have a directly linked cryogenic working area next to it. So that means what we can do, we can freeze down the samples in a defined way. And then we can take out the samples and temporarily store them in the cryogenic environmental. What is the benefit for this? First of all, we have, let's say, two applications with one device. And second, we can archive the sample quality because after the freezing, we have a cryogenic area where we can temporarily store the samples or where we can manipulate the samples. This equipment is available in different automation levels. So that means you can get either a standalone device, which is then semi-automated, or you can get a fully automated version just in case somebody is looking for something like 24/7 operation. Of course, this equipment is also then linked with scanners. So that means the identification and the recording on what is going on within the device is done automatically. Pretty cool. So this would be then, I would say, the first step within typical biobank process, the controlled rate freezing. What is even more common so far is the sample storage and automation. The way Askion is handling this is the so-called Askion Cylinder Hermetic Storage. It's for pure sample storage and sample manipulation within a cryogenic environmental. The sample storage takes place hereby in the vapor phase of liquid nitrogen. So that means there is no contact between the sample itself and liquid nitrogen. The main reason for this was, as has been shown by publication in the 80s, there's a huge risk if you put samples really submerged into liquid nitrogen for cross-contamination. In this time, it has occurred that, for example, bone marrow cells have been contaminated by hepatitis virus because there have been one sample within the liquid nitrogen tunnel. The samples has been submerged in liquid nitrogen, and then due to the contact with liquid nitrogen, there was a small leakage of the tube. And by this, the virus could be transmitted between various samples. Due to this, it would be better, from our opinion, to store the samples in the vapor phase. What we also have here, something like an automated sample handling. So that means you see here something like a small tank, also here behind, and on top there's a hood. Inside the hood, some robotic is mounted. And this robotic enables an automated sample handling. And herein, the sample handling takes place in a cold environmental. It also enables the lifting of the heavy compartments out of the tank. So that means nobody has to go there, lift it manually. No, this is done by the robotic. These devices are available in multiple sizes. So that means we have a small, medium, and large size device. Depending on what the operator is looking for, they can choose the device of interest according to capacity request and according to available space. Each of these devices, so non-dependent if you are talking about small, medium, or large, is available in various automation levels. So it means you can get either a standalone device for semi-automated operation, standalone with automated operation, or you can even link multiple devices to a fully automated biobank. Well, you might wonder why I just jumping here over. Today's focus is not to introduce the devices in detail. Therefore, there will be additional webinars. So today, it's just a brief overview. So please stop and interfere in case you have any questions on this, because I know it's might a lot of information. So please feel free to use the chat functionality to type in some questions here. The third topics of today would be the introduction about the documentation implementation part. So this is an own-developed database. It's a centralized database. An operator has to acquire this database only once, and then it will be hosted even by the biobank itself. The cool thing about this central database is this is the real brain behind the biobank. So it's performing an automated recording and reporting. Herein, reporting and recording, not only for single samples, but also for each device which is connected. So it means we can get not only the full life cycle of a sample, we also can get a full overview of our entire biobank. So we can see, okay, which kind of capacity is the left for storing of samples. I can see also who got access to it. So that means I have a user right management in behind. This makes it fully transparent with regards even of GMP documentation. It also has an open interface. So that means it can be also implemented to existing infrastructures. So in case somebody has an own his or LIMS system, there is an open interface to communicate with this. So that means there is no need to have redundant databases, so we can harmonize it. Well, now we are diving in a little bit about the scanner. The scanner, what you see here, is a portable scanner. So you can scan either SBS racks or boxes. And the main advantage so far is that you can scan samples at room temperature. You can scan samples on dry ice. So really you can submerge the scanner on dry ice. And you can even scan samples in the vapor phase. What it can be used for? Well, let's say so, if somebody has a minus 80 farm and he has to do an inventory, or he or she, then just put the scanner into the dry ice box, take the samples out, and then you can do an inventory without warming up the samples on typical application. What does it do? This scanner is reading the 2D bottom barcode, so the underneath barcodes of each vial, and it's reading also the either side barcode or the bottom barcode of the tube, of the box. So it means simultaneously, so within less than 3 to 4 seconds, the samples and the box will be identified. Thanks to an integrated analysis tool, there will be also no hidden license code. So that means the operator can connect here various devices. So you can use, for example, just a monitor, like a PC monitor or even a television monitor. You can connect also through a LAN cable. So that means you can even trigger it from external programs. You can connect via Wi-Fi. So that means you can connect something like a standard PC or even tablet PC. So that means you're highly flexible here. The fifth possibility, which just might be interesting, is if you're thinking about the biobanking process, we quite often have to transfer, let's say, existing sample collection to new biobanks. So that means we also need something like help for accessories. One of these accessories Astrion, for example, is offering is a so-called adapter solution. So that means previously non-coded tubes can be now transferred to adapters, first of all, to get a code on the tube, and second, to enable an automated sample transfer. It also contains something like small aluminum SBS racks, so that means some small equipment to even increase, for example, the precision freezing of samples. The background hereby is, thanks to aluminum, the conductivity for the samples will be better. And due to this, the homogeneity within one freezing bed can be even increased. It also contains something like external safety valves. So that means this is a motor-powered safety valve controlling the safe and secured liquid nitrogen flow. So that means there is no risk for liquid nitrogen floods anymore. Furthermore, there are other equipment which I don't want to dive in today. I think this is something so unique that we should exclude this for today. Something like transfer tools and sample for thawing of samples. But in case somebody would like to know it, just let us know and then we can have a separate discussion on this. The last part of today is the consulting. So that means what Astrion is also doing, in case a biobanker has the need, okay, I have a vision and I would like to put this vision into real, but I have no clue how to get from, let's say, my vision to my biobank. Well, then you can reach out to us and then we can support you. What we are doing here, we together with you or your team analyze the requirements. Out of this, we can develop workflows or we can even analyze existing workflows and put all of this together into, for example, a proposal or even one step further into a feasibility study. What does it mean? Let this put into a more accurate picture. For example, we have now a customer who said, okay, I would like to set up a new biobank. It should be automated. But the problem is I know that my funding is not that stable. So I have just now money. Then we can say, okay, then it would be best if you take, let's say, 10% of your funding for the infrastructure. You're taking additional 10% for the facility, just maybe to install something like ventilation. Maybe 20% is for consumables. An additional percentage then going to other topics like storage, controlled freezer, software, and so on. So that means we can do a study for you in case you would like to do so. And herein, we have the advantage that we have a good network, which means we can bring new partners on board in case the existing partners don't have the capability to establish, for example, your facility of choice. Well, all of this Sounds interesting, I would say. But I prefer to keep it more straightforward, to keep it more transparent. Just keep in mind, Askion is a partner for the biobanking part. So it means Askion is offering a modular system for biobanks, biorepository, which can fulfill nearly every workflow and which is scalable with regards of capacity, individual modules, and with regards of automation. So that means, keep in mind, Askion offers controlled rate freezing, sample transfer, sample storage, sample retrieval. Therefore, we have special equipment and software. And we're also supporting each biobank during the planning and realization. So it means in case you have an idea about the biobank, but you have maybe not all the partners on board which might be needed, just reach out to us or to our local partners like Tomas, and they are more than willing to support you. Well, after such a long story, we are getting nearly to the end. But before we are starting with the questions, please give me the time to advise you to the next online seminars. There will be additional 6 online seminars focusing on the individual topics that we have just touched today. So the next one will be, for example, about the scanner, how to use it, also including a live demo. The other one will be then focused on the controlled rate freezing. So that means here, and we will dive in deeper about the pitfalls and the solution. As part of this, we also will show then a little bit the scientific background, like for example, how the crystals behave and why accurate freezing is so important. The third topic will then about the sample storage. So that means how can we do some improvements for our biobank and how can we do the improvement to be prepared for the future. Then we will have also something like a more smiling introduction. So it means we will have an ice cream story. And as part of this, we show again the pitfalls with scientific background information, how we can archive the sample quality over the entire process. But herein, we are diving much deeper than today. So it means we are really going down to the scientific background information. The last two topics will then focus on the database. So that means we will also introduce our database more in detail, how the user management is working, how can we do the implementation, how can we do the management of a biorepository. And then as the last step, we also show then a live demo of this database. The topic which is shown here at the end is focusing on the consulting part. So that means herein, we give you something like a small guideline, how you can design your biobank. So what will be the typical questions? And this should support you in case somebody would like to plan a biobank. Now, I have spoken a lot. Now the floors would be yours to raise your questions. And herein, I would like to thank you for your participation and for your attention. And I would like to hand it over to the audience and to Dr. Prashant again, to raise the questions here to see if we have something unanswered today.
Thanks, Dr. Stephen. Thanks for the amazing talk. I think audience must have, you know, liked the talk, the way in which you have presented in the easiest way possible. So thanks for that. So I have a couple of questions, Dr. Stephen, for you. First, I would like to understand from you in which fields these equipments can be used and what are the benefits they would be getting out of it?
Yeah, good point, Dr. Prashant. You see, this is a good point to have a moderator like Dr. Prashant here. This equipment can be used, for example, in typical, of course, biobanks, biorepositories in general. Herein, we have already customers who are, for example, storing cells and also cells associated products. So in detail, we are talking about ATMPs. So the advantage therapeutic medical products, for example, pharmaceutical companies using this. Then we also have a couple of pathologists on board. They are mainly storing their tissues. And here the tissues really ranging from, let's say, something like small skin, muscles, going over to ovarian, so really a broad range of tissues. Besides this, we also have customers in the clinical chemistry field, for example. They are more or less associated to centralized labs, and they are storing a broad range, starting from cells, of course, going up to tissues, but also something like urine or stool. Then also, for example, blood, or let's say the individual blood fractions. And we also have, let's say, customers who are using the storage within the biological field. So for example, we also have customers storing bacteria and viruses belonging to up to class 3 safety level. And this is more or less our customer range. But in general, I would say as long as the sample format is not like an LKW, like a huge truck, it can be handled within the system.
Oh, thanks, Dr. Stephen. I would also like to understand from you is that for decades, for a very long time, scientists have been storing these samples as per their requirement in minus 20, minus 80 and liquid nitrogen tanks. So my question to you is that what was the main reason for Escion to establish and start offering a modular system? So would you like to shed some light here?
Oh yeah, good point. Well, there has been a couple of reasons to go for modular system and to go for the cold temperature. The modular system was more driven by the fact that we don't like to install a system which is oversized. The first reason is economic reason, because if you have an oversized biobank, for example, let's say you just would like to store 10,000 samples, but the capacity of the store is 1 million, then I just using 10% of it maximum, and the remaining 90% I just have to cool down, just maybe for future application. Well, we don't see it as a advantage, it's more like a disadvantage if you have such a huge store which is not used at the beginning. So it means we believe a biobank should grow according to the needs. First of all, we can save running costs. And second, we can also save the inverse cost. Yeah, because if I just starting small, I just need a small storage device. And then later on, I can expand. So that means my inverse cost at the beginning will be much smaller. For the temperatures, we have asked ourselves at the beginning if it's really a good idea, honestly speaking, to go to the cold temperatures. The main reason to go so was the physics in behind. The problem is, even if we are storing samples at minus 20, minus 80, this is might working for short term. But if you are thinking about periods longer than 3-6 months, the problem is that the physics don't like this temperature, because still some, let's say, sample damaging processes will occur. And due to this, we are losing the sample quality over time. To get this a little bit more simple, imagine we have done the freezing process in the best way. Then we will have within the sample something like small crystals. And over the time at higher temperatures, these smaller crystals will somehow combine to form larger ones. And these larger crystals then damaging the cell, for example, or let's say the sample. And therefore we analyzed together with the physicians that storage below minus 130 is the best, because at this temperature, this physical process is nearly completely stopped. I hope this is answering the question, because I'm not sure if this is the correct answer to your question. So maybe let me know if something is unclear or not.
Thanks, Dr. Stephen, for the answer. I think it is very clear that why modular systems are required. So I think we should open the discussion. If somebody from participants has any question for Dr. Stephen, please feel free to ask. So Dr. Stephen, there is one question from one of the participants. What is the meant by type of automation? Can you shed more light on modular freezing systems?
Okay, I think these are two questions. The first yes. question is about the automation. So automation for us means really a single tube picking, for example, for the storage. It also means then that the lift of the compartments out of the tank is automated, and it can go up to automate and to even link devices to one large biobank, for example, what you see here behind. So this one here, this is a typical setup how to link multiple devices to a fully automated biobank. So that means this would be the highest level of automation. So that means we have three levels. And out of this, the operator can decide what is their main interest. With regards of the freezing, we don't have, so our system cannot be compared with conventional minus 80 freezers, which you might know, they are available for multiple suppliers. Our system are completely based on liquid nitrogen. So that means our coolant is always liquid nitrogen. And for example, for our storage device, you could imagine it's something like a liquid nitrogen ton. And on the top, we have something like a hood. So it means conventional, more or less conventional liquid nitrogen ton, hood on top. And then we are storing inside the tank the samples, and inside the hood, we are performing the sample handling within the cryogenic environment. So maybe then to the audience or to the participant who raised the question, does this answer your questions or should we give further description about this?
So I think you have answered it correctly, Stephen. So we can wait for any from the participants if they have any other questions or if they want to understand about any of the concept what we have discussed today.
Well, what you also can do, of course, if somebody might not have a question right now. You can easily use this email address here. Just send an email either to the Premas team or to myself. And then we can even have a further discussion on specific topic, just in case somebody say, hey, something is still not answered during this session, no problem. Just send an email or give a call and then we can clarify this.
Sure. Thanks, Dr. Stephen. Now, may I hereby request all the participants that this is one survey which we have floated here. So if you can just, take out some time and answer these queries. So this will help us understanding what are the challenges you are facing and, which kind of solutions which we can offer. So my request, please, complete this survey. So, Dr. Stephen, there is one interesting question where a participant has asked, what is the longest storage time that has been tested on the SQN systems in terms of sample integrity? I think it's a very good question.
Oh, yeah, it's a really good question. So, let's say what we have tested at longest in-house was 3 years. This was the longest one. What has been tested by customers is now since 2010. So this is the longest period. So we are talking now about 11 years. And the interesting result has been they have seen no changes so far with the current methods of analysis. And this is, I would say, a good news for us because this shows that the equipment is really doing what it is designed for.
Stephen, there is one more question, that at what all stages the scanning takes place?
Okay. The scanning, we have to differentiate between devices. So within, for example, the controlled freezing devices, the scanning can be done at room temperature. It can be done at 4 degrees. And it can be done at temperatures down to minus 130 degrees. Within the storage device, the scanning always takes place in the cryogenic environment. So it means we are talking about temperatures between minus 100 and minus 130 degrees. For the CodeAI Plus, so for the portable scanner, here it depends on the environment. It could be room temperature, could be ice. So that means you are talking temperature range minus 10, minus 20 degrees, can be on dry ice. So minus 80 approximately, and it can be down to minus 140 degrees, minus 150 in the vapor phase.
My request to all the participants, if you have, if you want to understand more about the queries which you have, so please feel free to ask. Otherwise, we are also available to discuss in future as well as per your different requirements of how you what is bio, if you want us to conduct some more sessions, so which are already in line, so just feel free to reach out to us. Dr. Stephen, anything from your side to end this session? I mean, any closing remarks from your side?
Yes, one closing remark. Please feel free really to reach out either to the Primas team or to myself. And we would appreciate if you would join one of our next webinars. And herein, we would really appreciate to learn even from you. What are your major hassles? So please, when joining us, take your time to raise your questions, because we are here to answer your questions.
Thanks, Dr. Stephen, for the amazing talk today, and you discussed about the biobanking and what exactly science is looking forwards for in future. So I thank you for the expert talk today for biobanking solutions. And I would also like to thank all the participants for giving the time for this session. My request, please feel free to reach out to us if you have any queries, and if you want to have any specific sessions dedicated for your biobanking requirements, we would love to have those one-to-one sessions as well. With this, I would like to thank you all for joining us today, and I would be looking forward for more your participation in upcoming sessions as well. Thank you guys for joining us today. Thank you, everyone. Have a nice day. Bye-bye.